Good morning friends, today we are starting with the fourth part of HPLC method development. In previous part, we had discussed about the validation of HPLC optimized method, in which we have discussed about linearity and range, precision and specificity. Let's we look at the accuracy study. Accuracy is also called as closeness of test result to the true value. For bulk drug, the accuracy can be ascertained by analyzing a compound of known purity. The second way of doing accuracy for the bulk drug is comparison of the test result with another well-established method. For a drug product, accuracy study is performed by preparing a synthetic mixture with a known quantity of analyte, and then it is analyzed for the percentage recovery. The second way is add a known quantity of analyte in drug product and check its recovery. So these are the different ways by which accuracy study for bulk drug as well as for drug product can be carried out. Accuracy study should be carried out over three concentration range covering the entire range. The table for the accuracy study may be like this, where the analyte, which indicates the name of the analyte, the amount of sample that we have taken, and amount of standard that we are spiking. Ideally, the spiking of the standard sample is carried out at 50%, 100% and 150% level. The amount of analyte which is found by performing analysis and average percentage recovery is being determined. So that is how accuracy study is being performed in HPLC method. The fifth parameter is quantitation limit, which indicates the minimum amount of analyte that can be detected and quantified. The various approach that is used for the determination of quantitation limit are visual approach and signal to noise ratio. Visual approach, as the name indicates, where visually we are determining whether the drug is quantifiable or not. And in signal to noise ratio, the response of blank is determined, which is considered as noise, and the signal to noise ratio of 10:1 is considered as the quantitation limit. So the blank response is considered as 1, and the response of compound, which is 10 times that of blank response, is considered as quantitation limit. The second way is based on standard deviation and slope, where LOQ, that is limit of quantification, is equal to 10 multiplied by standard deviation upon slope, where sigma is the standard deviation of either blank response or standard deviation of y-intercept of regression line, and S is the mean of the slope. So using that equation also, limit of quantification can be determined. This is one of the chromatogram where the limit of quantification for this compound, which is 10 times that of blank response, is considered as LOQ. The sixth parameter is detection limit, which is the minimum amount of analyte that can be detected. And the same approach are used for the evaluation of detection limit, that is visual approach, and second is signal to noise ratio. Here, signal to noise ratio of 3:1 is considered as the detection limit. And the equation based on standard deviation and slope is LOD is equal to 3.3 into sigma upon slope, where sigma is standard deviation of y-intercept line or standard deviation of blank response, and S is the mean of slope. And this is one of the chromatogram where peak at 9.6 minute is the LOD of the chromatogram. The seventh parameter is robustness. It shows that the small but deliberate changes have no significant effect on the method, which means that we have to carry out a small deliberate changes in conditions like small change in pH values, composition of the mobile phase, sample extraction time, temperature of the analysis, flow rate of the analysis, or different lots of column, and study the effect of these small but deliberate change on the chromatogram and the analysis. These small changes should be done up to 10% of the optimized condition, and effect of such changes on the analysis should be evaluated. The table how the parameters can be reported for the robustness studies are given as below. You can mention the method parameters like change in the mobile phase ratio or flow rate, mention the normal condition and the normal retention time that you are getting, and after making some deliberate changes, what are the differences that are obtained, or what are the deliberate changes that you are doing, that is reported over here, and what is the effect of this deliberate change on the retention time of the drug is being mentioned over here. So that is how robustness studies and robustness parameters can be reported. Fine. So after completing the validation parameters, now let's we move to the system suitability parameter. To check the suitability of the instrument and the method for the analysis, system suitability test has to be carried out. Every day before starting analysis, prepare the test concentration solution and run in an equilibrated HPLC system. Check that all the system suitability parameters are within the limit. For HPLC method, various system suitability parameters are as below: retention time, theoretical plate, capacity factor, asymmetric factor, and resolution. Let's we see how we can determine all these parameters. The first parameter is retention time. The second parameter is theoretical plate. It is a measure of column efficiency. As the number of theoretical plates increases, the column efficiency also increases. Minimum 2000 theoretical plates are essential as acceptable column parameter. Theoretical plate can be determined using following equation. If your peak is symmetrical or Gaussian, then use following equation. Number of theoretical plates is equal to 16 in the bracket T upon W whole square, where T is the retention time of the compound and W is the peak width. As it is given in this chromatogram, peak width, that is called as W, and retention time. Theoretical plates can also be determined at peak width at half peak height, because many a times it is difficult to determine peak width at baseline level. So if you determine peak width at half height, which is easy to determine, so using this equation, n is equal to 5.54 in the bracket T upon W half whole square, you can determine the number of theoretical plates. Now suppose the peak is asymmetric in nature, then we have to determine first asymmetric factor and use following equation. Now how to determine asymmetric factor, that we will discuss in the next parameter, but the equation for determining number of theoretical plate is given in this way, where W.1 is peak width at 10% height and asymmetric factor 0.1 is asymmetric factor at 10% height. The third parameter is asymmetric factor. It measures the peak symmetry. It is the ratio of peak width to the right of the retention time and to the left of the retention time. So AF is equal to B upon A, which is shown in this chromatogram. Peak width to the right of the retention time and peak width to the left of the retention time. So B by A. Ideally, for symmetric peak, asymmetric factor would be 1, but the acceptable values are 0.7 to 1.5. The fourth parameter is capacity factor, K dash, and it is also called as retention factor. It estimates whether the elution of analyte occurs rapidly or not. If the capacity factor is less than 1, which means that elution occurs rapidly, which is not acceptable. Now how to determine capacity factor? Capacity factor K dash is equal to T minus T0 upon T0, where T is the retention time of the compound and T0 is the pot time. So you can determine capacity factor using equation T minus T0 upon T0. Ideally, capacity factor should be between 2 to 10. Fifth system suitability parameter is resolution. When there are more than one compound which are being eluted and separated by the chromatography, resolution should also be considered as an important system suitability parameter. It represents the ability of a system to separate two analytes. The acceptable resolution between two peak is two or more. The resolution can be determined using following equation. For a Gaussian peak, resolution R is equal to 2 in the bracket T2 minus T1 upon W1 plus W2, where T2 and T1 are the retention time of compound 2 and compound 1, and W1 and W2 are their respective peak width. But suppose one of the peak is asymmetrical. In such condition, resolution can also be determined using equation T2 minus T1 upon W1R plus W2L, where W1R is the peak width to the right of retention time T1, and W2L is the peak width to the left of retention time T2. So by putting this value, we can determine the resolution. Ideally, the resolution value should be more than 2. Now, how to represent a system suitability parameters? Parameters like retention time, theoretical plates, capacity factor, asymmetric factor, and resolution can be kept in a table, and the values are represented for compound 1 and compound 2 along with its standard deviation value. Before starting a routine analysis, first run a system suitability sample and check that all these parameters are within the limit. Then only start the quality control analysis, and that is the purpose of system suitability study.